Well, thank you all for coming to this meeting. And basically, as Anne has said, it's very difficult to get truthful information about what is happening in Venezuela, but generally what is happening across Latin America. And there is a very good reason for that. That reason is that in Venezuela we have a revolution. In most of Latin America, there are either revolutionary processes going on or movements towards revolution. And obviously the owners of the mass media have economic interest, have powerful political interest. They are not interested in us knowing about these revolutions, just in case we get the idea that we can do the same thing in our own countries. So there's a very good reason for this media manipulation. And it can only be broken by meetings like this, by showing documentaries, by organizing delegations both ways and so on. Now, what is happening in Venezuela is not an isolated development. It's part of a continent-wide movement that you could say probably started in 1999-2000. In January 2000, there was a big uprising in Ecuador. It was the Assembly of the Peoples of Ecuador. They blockaded most of the country. They gathered in the capital, and they basically overthrew the government. The government of the day, and that was maybe the first big movement of this Latin American revolutionary wave that we are witnessing now. And in order to understand where that comes from, you have to go back to the 10 years earlier. In 1990, the situation that we saw throughout Latin America was one on where, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, there was a massive propaganda campaign to say that the socialism had been tried, had failed, that maybe capitalism wasn't the best possible system, but there was no alternative, it was the only system possible. And this campaign had a big impact in the movements, in the working class movements, in the peasant movements, the left-wing movements that existed throughout the continent. Many of them suffered defeats at that particular time. Even many leading figures, even people had been leading figures in guerrilla movements, even swallowed this propaganda campaign, and they basically changed sides. One of the most glaring examples of this is Joaquin Villalobos, someone who was one of the main guerrilla commanders in El Salvador, and then became a neoliberal advocate, and is now an advisor to President Uribe, right-wing President Uribe in Colombia, on counter-insurgency. In Venezuela, we had a similar situation. Many of the leaders of the guerrillas became ministers in the government in the 1990s, including one, Teodoro Petkov, who was in charge of the program of privatization of state-owned industries and so on. In general, it was a time where the neoliberal agenda was implemented in a very harsh way throughout Latin America. And what does this agenda consist of? Well, one is the destruction of any trade barriers and any tariff barriers to allow the multinationals to completely dominate these countries' economies. Two, the selling out of state property, state assets, the utilities, electricity companies, telecoms, the airlines, and so on. In most of these countries were privatized. They were sold for very low prices to multinational companies, which bought them and then immediately decapitalized these companies. That is, they took away any assets that they had, they completely destroyed these companies, they put the prices up, sacked the workers, destroyed the trade union contracts, and so on. And together with all this, governments passed laws which destroyed any advances that working people had made in these countries for a long period of time in relation to collective bargaining rights, trade union rights, employment rights, wage negotiations, and so on. It was basically a generalized attack on this, on the conditions of working people in these countries and their organizations. And this, at the beginning, it seemed to create economic growth. Many of these countries had reasonable rates of economic growth. There was a lot of foreign direct investment going in. But as I said, this foreign direct investment was not based on developing the production of the economy of these countries, but rather on just taking, it's just a grab and run type of investment. And this happened throughout Latin America. At the same time that there was certain economic growth, this didn't have any impact, any positive impact on the living standards of the majority of the population. On the contrary, living standards went down throughout the 1990s. after they had completely stagnated in the 1980s, which was known as the lost decade in Latin America. So this is what created the conditions for this revolutionary movement that is taking place now. Even though the leaders of many of these movements completely accepted the general wisdom that capitalism was fine and there was no alternative, the masses of the population were forced once again at the beginning of the 2000s into struggle. And there were some very important struggles. For instance, in Cochabamba, Bolivia, there was a massive movement against the privatization of water, and they managed to win. But they could only win by using very radical mass organization methods. There was the Coordinadora del Agua, coordinating committee that united all different sections that were on struggle, the peasants, the workers, the factory workers union, the students, population in general, and they based the mobilization on mass meetings that took place every day in the main square, an elected committee that was the only one authorized to negotiate, but they were not authorized to take decisions without consulting the mass meetings. And we're talking here about mass meetings of 20,000, 40,000, even to 100,000 people at the peak of the movement. And finally, this movement achieved what we can call even insurrectionary proportions, in the sense that for a number of days, the police and the army were not even able to enter the city. Such was the resistance of the people. At one point, the authorities decided to kidnap and basically arrest the whole of the committee, Coordinadora del Agua, all the representatives, but the movement continued regardless, and they managed to defeat the privatization of water. So this is another characteristic of these movements in the 2000s, that throughout the 1970s and 80s, the movement of workers and peasants in Latin America had suffered a whole number of defeats, very bloody defeats, and military dictatorships were introduced in a whole number of countries.